almost at Angry Glad. We aren't at Angry Glad in this church. Praise God. You ought to be glad because you got power. Amen. You ought to be glad because you have authority. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. You ought to be glad because you're saved. Amen. The Bible says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Amen. You ought to be glad because you're redeemed. Amen. Amen. Say, I am redeemed. Amen. Praise God. Bought with a price. The price, amen, that Jesus paid on Calvary's cross. Amen. Praise God for Jesus. Praise God for Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God for Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise God for Jesus. Jesus Christ, with all of our sins imputed upon him, that was Jesus before the cross. Amen. Before the cross, he had all of our sins upon him. Amen. He was full of sickness and full of disease. Amen. And had no place to lay his head. That was Jesus before going to the cross. He was the Redeemer for those who were lost. Amen. He was the Savior, the Lamb of God that went to the cross. That was Jesus before the cross. And unfortunately, a lot of us as believers still live like that. We still live at the bottom of the cross. We still live at the feet of Jesus. Amen. On that cross, bleeding and beaten and hardly looking like a man. We still look up at that Jesus and say, oh, Jesus. And you see yourself as Jesus is, or as Jesus was, and not as Jesus is. And the Bible says that we are as he is. in this world. And if you don't grab a hold of that, you will always be a Christian that's living a pitiful, unsuccessful life. With no power and no authority and always speaking doom and damnation upon yourself and always feeling like you under and not above, like you're the tail and not the head. You'll always feel like you're bloody and you're diseased, and you'll speak about your sickness and your disease more than the grace and the glory of God.
Amen.
You'll always speak about where you were and not where you are right now. You'll never see yourself after the cross. You'll only see yourself before the cross. You'll only see yourself as a sinner, lost, as a sinner, you know, full of sin, on your way to hell, at the feet of the cross. The song said, at the cross where I first saw the light and the burdens of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy. Amen. So the happiness is the fact that you gave your life to Christ at the bottom of the cross. Amen. And you did it simply by faith.
Amen.
And now life is after the cross. So Jesus, amen, who's our Redeemer, who's our Savior, amen, is no longer on the cross. Now, I know that's bad news for you, some of you. Amen. But Jesus is no longer on the cross for those of us who are saved and those of us who have been redeemed. Praise God for those who are lost. He's still on the cross for them because they haven't met him yet. Amen. But if they have faith, then they can say, at the cross where I first saw the light. It's for them. But for us, we have got to go, say, beyond the cross. We got to go beyond the cross because Jesus is beyond the cross. Jesus is no longer on the cross. Amen. He is now seated at the right hand of God. Amen. He's seated there, amen, in this new body. He's seated there he's glorified. He is seated there, amen. He's already sprinkled his blood on the mercy seat there, amen. He's there as our intercessor. He's there as our overseer. He's there as our brother, amen. He's your Redeemer at the cross. He's your Savior, amen, at the cross. But now beyond the cross, when you've accepted him, he is your brother. He's your brother, amen. He is your brother. He is your Lord. And he is seated at the right hand. So you've got to recognize. Say recognize.
Amen.
You've got to recognize your source of power.
Amen.
You have got to recognize your source of power. Say, I got to recognize.
My source of power.
Meaning you've got to know where the power comes from. You got to know where the power comes from. You got to know that you are powerful. You got to know that you are powerful and that you have authority over every situation in your life. Amen. If you never take authority, you'll always live like you lived prior to the cross. No power, no authority. Beaten, sick, diseased. Broken, thinking about death all the time, thinking about your past all the time, but we're no longer in that place. We have gone beyond the cross. And don't feel bad. God wants you beyond the cross. Amen. The cross was a place of crucifixion. It was a place of death. In our day, it's like the electric chair. So who wants to stay right there around the electric chair? Who wants to stay right there around the lethal injection? None of us. We want to go beyond the cross so that we can be in the place where we are as he is in this world today. You are as he is. Now listen, the problem with this is this. This is the problem. Here's the problem. Here comes the problem. We can't help but seeing ourselves in the natural. We cannot help but think about things in the natural because in the natural is where we live in the physical. In the spirit is where we live in the spirit up here. And God said to think above and not beneath. So our thoughts, we should have the mind of Christ to think up here. No matter what's going on in your life, you cannot think about it on this level. I said, no matter what's going on, you can't think about it on this level, on this natural level. And this is the deceptive part. Even when things are going good, you can't think about them on this level. You got a whole bunch of stuff going good, and you're thinking about it on this level, and then soon as everything falls apart, you got to climb up here.
Come on, God.
Ain't no need of doing that. Always think above. Even if you're walking in blessings, it's because of God. Even if you're in favor, it's because of God. Even if you got enough money, you ain't worried about finances, it's because of God. Even if your body's not sick, it's because of God. So as long as you're always thinking up here, when trouble comes, it doesn't matter. You're always thinking above and not beneath. You always realize you're the head and not the tail. Even when things are good, you still pray. When you think above, see, you're not moved based on what's happening down here. You pray all the time, whether things are good or things are not so good. You're already in season and out of season, amen. Because you're not thinking on the natural. Reason being is because you're not natural. You're supernatural. I don't know anybody in their right mind want to be natural. If you're comfortable being natural, if you're comfortable operating in your physical, then you don't understand that there's another part, a greater part. You're supernatural. You're supernatural. You are spiritual, amen. Amen. You are more spirit than anything. The spirit is the part that gives you the eternal life. Your physical part is dying. It's been dying since the day you took your first breath. But it's the Spirit of God that lives in and dwells on the inside of you that has eternal life. It is the life of Christ that's on the inside of you that will live even after this body's gone to the grave. Amen. Praise God for our spirit. We are spiritually alive. Amen. I say we're spiritually alive. And so, if I'm spiritually alive, I've got to recognize the source of power. When I recognize the source of power, I take dominion over every area of my life. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. No, makes no sense. Believers are sick and not fighting.
Amen.
You sick as a believer? You might be sick, but you ought to be fighting.
Amen.
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 You ought to be fighting. You ought to take dominion over your sickness.
Right.
Amen.
Yes.
Dominion over your sickness.
Yes.
And you ought to get mad about it.
Yes.
You ought to get mad about it.
Yes.
You ought to get mad about it. You ought to get mad and say the devil got his nerves to trespass on God's property.
Yes.
I belong to God.
Yes.
My body is the temple of the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
He messing with the temple.
Yes.
He messing with the temple of God.
Yes.
And you think God can do, God can't do anything about it if you don't do something about it. Amen. You waiting on God to come. God said, I already gave you power. I already gave you authority. What you crying to me for? What you coming to me crying and whining? That's what he said to Moses when he was at the Red Sea. Oh God, I don't brought these people out now at the Red Sea. What are we going to do? God said, stand up on your feet.
Yes, sir.
Stretch forth that rod I gave you.
Yes,
that same rod that turned water to blood. That same rod that you laid on the ground and it ate the Pharaoh's steak. Put that rod to work. Stretch forth that rod.
Yes, sir.
That's what he did. And God telling some of us, what you crying about?
Yes.
Take dominion.
Yes.
Take dominion. Over pastor. I still see myself at see when you see yourself at the cross, you don't understand the source of your power. If you never see yourself past the cross, you're gonna get to heaven. Because once you're born again, you're born again. Once you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, once you receive Him, the Bible said if you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, you believe in your heart, confess with your mouth, you shall be saved. Now some unbelievers will tell you, no, that ain't true. They debate the Bible.
Yeah.
The Bible says it is true.
Yeah.
If the Bible says it's true, it's true.
Amen.
Well, what about if a person lives this way? Everybody got them what ifs.
Uh-huh.
Just live for the Lord. Don't worry about what if. You just live for God. You just live your life for the Lord. Let them worry about the what ifs. But the grace of God. It is the grace of God that keeps us. Because you ain't lying yesterday. That ain't got nothing to do with nothing. Y'all not lying. Because you didn't steal or fornicate or commit adultery. You esteem yourself on a high. Man, you walk out to the devil and take your mind somewhere. Jesus said it's not just a physical act. It's not just the fact that you didn't bodily sleep with somebody. He said if you think about it. If you angry, that's murder. We don't kill some folk up in here. Have you ain't pulling no trigger. You ain't pull that box cut out, but you don't thought about it. You don't been angry enough at your brother. You ain't had to say, I wish you were there. You just thought about it. I see some of the smirks on your face. I see you think, oh yeah, you don't went back in your memory now. Jesus said, in the old covenant, you had to do it. When Jesus came, he said, you didn't think about it. So he says, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But thank God for his grace. Thank God that when you had that thought, he didn't put you out of salvation. You didn't lose your salvation. You didn't lose it. You can't be born again. Again. You can't be born and then say, you unborn. No, you born. You've been born again. And no one in the Bible says you unborn at this point. When you do this, then you're unborn. No, you're born again. And it's the grace. See, when you understand the grace, it causes you not to sin. It causes you to fall in love with God. When you really understand the grace of God, it don't cost you to run out there and say, well, I just got a license to sin and do whatever I want to do. No, it makes you see how much God loves you. He loves me that he would redeem me, that he would still bring me back, that he would still cover me and love me. And it makes you say, sin has no dominion over me. Sin has no dominion over me because of the love of God. Praise God. My first verse here in the book of John. Isaiah 14:12 says, how are you? Now it should have been 14:2. Isaiah 14:2. This is Isaiah when he was prophesying. He was prophesying about the Savior to come. You know, he was a prophet, so he was speaking about the Savior coming and what it was going to mean. It says, then people will take them and bring them to their place. Isaiah 11:2. Go to John 14:12. I think that was put in wrong. John 14:12. That's my first one. Praise God. Behind the cross, beyond the cross, past the cross, is where the Bible says we are as he is in this world. Not as he was.
Right.
Listen, you every day you have got to see yourself. Every day you've got to see yourself with dominion over your problem.
Amen.
Let me tell you something. Your problem, your crisis, your problem, your issue is not something that God has authored in your life, but he's allowed.
Amen.
And those things are allowed to bring you to the place where you'll begin to fight. When you'll begin to stand. Listen, it had it not been for some trouble you had in your life, you wouldn't know how good God is. And it's designed. God is constantly trying to bring that dominion side of you out. That you get sick in your body, you get a bad report. God said, here's an opportunity. Here's an opportunity for that dominion side to come out. Well, here it is, right here. Somebody treats you wrong, here's an opportunity for that power and dominion to come out. Amen. Most assuredly, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also. And great, say great. How many of you believe in him?
Amen.
How many of us believe in him? Come on, man, raise your hand. Believe in him, the works that you do. Let me put your hands up. Let me tell you something. sometimes when the pastor's up here and he's speaking, amen, he's standing on the platform of the Lord, not this platform, but the platform of the Lord, some on the platform that y'all don't see, amen. And he's speaking, and you believe, and he's speaking from God, and he says, how many of you believe, and you don't raise your hand, let me tell you something, you're missing out on blessings. You don't understand the reason why you're not raising your hand, not because you didn't hear what he said, you're not raising your hand because the adversary is holding your hand down. You think it's you. The adversary is so deceptive that you think you got something to do with what you do. Jesus said to Peter that he was going to die in this net. Peter said, no, we're not going to have him. Jesus turned around and looked at him and said, get thee behind me, Satan. He said, because what you're saying is not of God, but it's of man. Now check this out. He said, get thee behind me, Satan. He said, what you're saying is not of God, but of man. Now, he didn't say it's not of God, it's of Satan. He said it's not of God, it's of man. So that tells you whenever you think as a man, you're thinking on the same line Satan does. You ain't got your own mind. You ain't got your own mind. Either you're thinking like God, or you're thinking like man and the devil. God said, he said, what you're saying is not of God, it's of man. But wait a minute, you just say, get thee behind me, Satan. You ain't say, get thee behind me, man. You better watch your thoughts. Amen. Now listen to me. The devil ain't going to never tell you to raise your hand for the Lord. He ain't going to never say, how many of you believe? So if you hear that and it's talking about Jesus, you ought to put him up. Amen. The devil, it ain't the devil telling you to put it up for Jesus. It says, most surely I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also. Not might do, not can do, will do. Will do. Well, that will ought to fall on the inside of you. Especially if you know what Jesus has done. He said, the works that I do, you will do also. You will do also. And great, say great. Greater works than these he will do, because I go to my Father. Jesus said, because I'm going to my Father, you are going to do greater works. Because as I am, so are you in this world. As I am, so are you. As I am, so are you in this world. Praise God. You have dominion. Because you are beyond the cross. You are beyond the cross. You got to recognize. Say recognize. You got to recognize who you are. You got to recognize the source of your power. Amen. Praise God. Go to Isaiah there. Recognize the source of your power. That's Isaiah 11:2. Recognize the source of the power that you have. Isaiah said, the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him. The Spirit of wisdom and understanding. He's talking about Jesus. He's prophesying about Jesus before Jesus came. The Spirit of counsel and might. The Spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. That's what he's saying. He said, this power is going to rest upon him. Who is it going to rest upon? It's going to rest upon the one that's on the inside of you. It's going to rest upon the one that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost for. Your body is a temple, and Jesus lives on the inside of you. That's why you have wisdom. That's why you have knowledge. That's why you got the Spirit of God living on the inside of you, and you have got to take dominion. Children of God, you have got to take dominion. I'm telling you, all of you are saved. Most of you here are saved. I believe that. And I'm saying that because this is, you know, we come to church, you can't get no more saved. Once you say, you say, you can't get no more saved. Amen. Amen. Once you're on the base, baby, you're on the base. You can't, I don't care. You people can't talk you into being no more saved. You are saved. If you die today, you're still as saved today as you will be 20 years from now. Now you might be more disciple. You might be able to do more work, but you are saved. And you are not coming to church to get saved again. You are not coming to get saved again. You ought to come here so that you can begin to operate in the power and the authority. Amen. You ought to come here, you ought to leave here, and you ought to operate in the dominion In the grave, if God say you'll do the same thing, you all come and say, I'm expecting you to do the same thing. I'm expecting you to do something good. Amen. I'm not locked at the cross. I'm not at the foot of the cross. I'm not still looking up like John and Mary and then was looking up at Jesus. Jesus, newsflash, he already died. He already been buried. He already resurrected with all power. He is seated at the right hand of God. Looking at him all you want to. He is not there. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. And you are seated with him in heavenly places. Amen. So we have got to begin to walk and talk in the authority and speak from our mouth with authority and with power. I'm telling you, don't let anybody tell you you don't have to come to church. You ought to be in church hearing the word of God around people, amen, that believe God's word. You can't get this nowhere else. You need to be a place where you can be encouraged and you can encourage somebody in the word of God. Amen. Praise God. Go to my next one here. You need to be in a place where you can hear the word of God. Colossians 1 and 10, that you may walk worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing him, being fruitful in every good works and increasing in the knowledge of God. You got to walk with God. Amen. Child of God, you cannot walk with God if you are not praying. If you are not spending time with God. Stop fooling yourself. You cannot just come here on Sunday morning and everything is all right. It don't work that way. You've got to pray. We have prayer here on Monday and Friday. Noonday prayer. I don't have a mind to remind you of stuff. I'm just not programmed that way. Once we say it, if it's interest, if you got an interest, you ought to press your way in. Amen. Amen. You don't have to be reminded to eat.
That's right.
Nobody has to remind you to drink or go to the bathroom.
Right.
You have an urge to do those things. You have a desire to do those things. Amen.
Amen.
You ought to have a desire to be in prayer.
Amen.
You ought to have a hunger and a thirst to be in prayer. Maybe you can't make it all the time, but you ought to press your way. You ought to make plans. I'm going at 11 o'clock, or I'm going at 6 o'clock on Monday evening. We have prayer from 11:45 to 12:45, Monday and Friday. Y'all not do it. Don't do it for me. If you don't do it because you got a hunger and a thirst. But you got to pray. You so busy you can't pray. You so busy you can't call on, you can't be with God. Let me tell you something. That's why, you know, God is walking right by you. That's good. He's walking right with you. But when you don't pray, he's like this all the time. Everywhere you go, God said, I'll never leave you or forsake you. But because you don't spend time with him, although he's walking with you, you think he's so far away. Because you don't talk to him. You don't give him a chance to answer. You don't give him a chance to be with you. So because of that, you think, oh, God is so far away. Now I got to pray to get back in his grace. When he said, I'll never leave you, nor will I forsake you. So the devil say, oh, God's a distance from you now. You don't draw a wedge between you and God. Now, no, God was with you the whole time. But when you don't pray, you never know. The reason we don't pray, I'm going to use myself. Thank you, man. The reason I wasn't praying as much because I didn't realize the dominion I had. When you don't understand the power and the authority you have in Jesus' name, then you just pray when things happen.
Amen.
You know, when them emergency prayers, you need to get out of debt. You need some bill money, amen. You need your rent money. You need some gas in your car. You pray right then. God is always with you.
Amen.
When you know who you are and you take dominion, your situation today has never changed with God.
That's right.
You're in the same place with God that you were the very first time. It's just that you haven't spent time praying and walking with him. As a child of God, we have got to walk with God. Jesus himself prayed. Jesus himself fasted for 40 days and 40 nights. He fasted and he was with God. He got up early many mornings and he went up in the mountains to be with the Father. Jesus did this. If Jesus did this, I certainly need to do it. I certainly need to do it. We have an urge and a hunger on the inside of us to say, you need to pray. And because we don't feel like it, we don't pray. Tell God, we got to pray. We got to pray. We won't be able to walk in dominion if we don't pray. You won't be able to come out of that situation if you don't pray. Amen. Look at the demons, the hordes of demons that the adversary has released. Amen. He has released a lot of demons, haven't he? Man, these demons are all over the place. And we can't fight them. Because we haven't been praying, so all we know is natural stuff. Getting our city council together, getting our mayor together, getting the governor together, and putting all these marches together and all these things, amen, and them demons marching right along with us. Amen, them demons sitting on stage with the rest of them, amen. I'm telling you, that's exactly what Satan wants us to do. He wants us to look at a spiritual problem in the natural. And think if we get more jobs and if we get more of this and more of that, all of this stuff will go away. The devil is a lie. Amen. 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 And we want these platforms where we can all come together and sing Kumbaya. That stuff ain't going to work. Because it's not a natural problem. Amen. Amen. It's a spiritual problem. And the devil just kicked back on vacation because he said they don't took the bait. They fight against each other. He can get us on the race then. He can get us on the race deal. Because we put our salvation down. We take our collars off, lay them to the side. Because this got something to do with race. I ain't going to wear my collar now. This by my race. My peoples. My peace. So I'm saved, but when it comes to race, when it comes to my race, I'm putting my collar down because I got to stand with the brothers. Amen. Because we've been done wrong. And the devil's sitting up there laughing at us, skinning and grinning. Say, I'm going to kill them all. I'm going to kill the black ones. I'm going to kill the white ones. I'm going to kill the Hispanics, I'm going to kill the Chinese, I'm going to kill all of them. He don't care about none of us. And we sitting there taking our stuff off. Because we worried about our race. Oh, I'm as worried about the race as anybody. The Christian race.
Glory!
Because let me tell you something. When your eyes close, when you close your eyes on this side, and you break the skies, ain't got nothing to do with race. Ain't got nothing to do with being a Baptist, a Pentecostal, Lutheran, none of that stuff. All that stuff gonna fall off. Your spirit ain't got no color. It's either lost or it's saved. Amen. Amen. Put that in your pipe and smoke. I'm telling you, you better stop being bamboozled. Taking the hokey doke. That's what the devil's doing. The devil is deceiving us. And what's happening? We're going down with the world. The church is going down with the world because we ain't got enough to stand.
Yes.
And this, the Jews, Jesus came for the Jews. The Jews didn't deal with the Gentiles. The man wouldn't even stop when the Samaritan was down. He kept on passing on the other side of the street. Racism always been around. Slavery always been around. Amen. They ain't just pop up since we pop up on the scene. It's always been nothing new under the sun. Nothing new under the sun. Amen. If we don't put our minds on things above and begin to pray, before long, the fight gonna look like it's out of reach. It's not going to be out of reach. It's going to look like it's out of reach. Even now, to some, the fight looks like it's out of reach. Because we worried about the wrong thing.
That's it.
People call me to march, I pray. What are we going to do tomorrow? Okay, we're going to march today. Tomorrow, what are we going to do? We're going to gather at the lapel, and then we're going to come together, and we're going to talk. And then, okay, after we do that, what are we going to do tomorrow? What's going to happen tomorrow? And what's going to happen the next day?
Right.
Nothing. Till somebody else get killed. Then we'll come back together. Call Channel 3, 12, 6, and Fox. Get our picture on TV. Maybe the newspaper. And then we'll show up again with the next incident. What are we going to do after that? What are we going to do after that? I tell you what, just make me want to slap somebody. You wake up, like, wake up. Don't you see the devil hand all over this? We ought to be somewhere praying. And until everything turns around. How long do we pray? We pray without ceasing. We keep on praying. We keep on turning our faces to God. You understand? This is a spirit. The Bible says our weapons are not. We wrestle not against all that flesh and blood stuff. Take it. You know, whatever. Go to the next verse. Okay. Listen to me. Don't be fooled by the devil. The devil is behind it. Oh, no, Pastor. White man behind it. You don't know. The white man. No, it's the devil.
Amen.
Lucifer. Who rebelled against God. Lucifer, who took a third of the angels with him when God kicked him out of heaven. Lucifer is behind him. He ain't got no cover. Lucifer is the one behind him. Them fallen angels, where you think they're at right now? They're demons. Unclean spirits, wicked spirits. The devil is only one. He ain't all over the place. The devil, no, it ain't the devil. It's his helpers. The little demons. Those spirits all over the place. Where did they go? When a third of angels left, where did they go? Nobody's in hell yet because hell has not even been opened for the devil. So where are these little demons at? Where are these little spirits at? Running around looking for a body, somebody they can live in. They rebelled against God along with Lucifer. So what are they doing now? Still rebelling against God. But they're spirits without bodies, without forms, and they need a body to live in. And they're living in everyone that will allow them to come in. And it's millions of them. Millions of them. Hordes of them that are released and have been released in this earth.
Amen.
You better know that. And they're looking for somebody, anybody, and just walk inside. Use your hands, use your body, use your mouth, use your body. Do you think a woman give her body away, or a man sleeping around all over the place? You think, oh, he is possessed by a demon. She is possessed by a demon. What these people, look. All this mental illness. How much mental illness is there? When did we get to the point where we couldn't just go to our doctor and be a walk-in? Now, man, you can't even do that because the hospitals are full of people who are sick, who are diseased. Don't you see how far away we've gotten from God? You can't, I don't care how sick you are. Your doctor tell you it's going to be 3 weeks, go to an emergency room. Because we can't get you in. What is that saying? It's saying the devil got a lot of people sick. The devil got a lot of people diseased. You mean they still got viruses, Zika and stuff that's coming on the scene? They still got stuff we ain't never heard of that's coming and killing people, deforming babies? Don't you see the devil all over that? All over it? The devil is deforming children. His objective is to destroy the family. And he'll say, I'll do it by any means necessary. If I got to take a man and make him think he's a woman, or a woman and make her think that she's a man, if I got to infect a little baby before they're born, I'll do whatever I can to destroy the human race. The devil, Satan, who was a little bitty serpent in the garden. Now in Revelation, he's a full-blown dragon. Who said, God said, from here on you'll eat the dust of the earth. He's been eating a lot of dust. What's the dust? And God formed man from the dust. And man became a living soul. So what is Satan eating? Us. And he gone from a little bitty serpent in the garden to now in Revelation, he's a full-blown dragon. You think you better not be watching your children? You think you better not be praying over those children and taking dominion over your body? You think you got time to do anything else? You got time to do nothing? You find you got time to do something, you better be praying. You better be walking with God. Because I'm telling you, one person that ain't playing is the devil. Look at your watches all you want to say. It's almost time you got to know. The devil got plenty of time. He's been doing this for 6,000 years. He pretty good at it. He's been on the job alone. He knows how to deceive us. He knows how to destroy us. And he's doing it at every turn. And if you and me, if we don't take dominion, if we don't go beyond the cross, see, the devil, he cool. He love it, the fact that we at the cross. Singing at the cross where I first saw the light. You don't saw the light now, baby. Move on past the cross. Get on past the cross and start walking in your dominion. And start being as he is in this world. He left you so that you would do what he did. So that we would do greater works than he did. Amen. He said, move. You don't come on past the cross and lay hands. You can't lay hands at the cross. You can't command demons to go at the cross. You can only do that past the cross. You got my next one there? I give you another? Yeah. Go to, I'm almost finished, y'all. Praise God. Matthew 16, 18 to 19. Okay. And also, say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. He said, on this rock I'm going to build my church. We are the church. He wasn't talking about a rock. We are the church. Jesus is the head. We are the body. We're the church. He said, on this I'm going to build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail. Listen, hell can't get past us. Hell can't get past you to come to your house if you know who you are. If you know who you are, and listen, okay, all of us, I'm included, I don't let hell get past me sometimes. But hell ain't gonna stay. Hell got to go. Hell got to go. And I let you in because I didn't have knowledge, and people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. But now that I know, hell, you got to go. You got to go. Because I'm the church, and the gates, and I represent a gate. I represent a fence. I represent a hedge. And you can't come in my house and do what you want to do. Amen. You cannot come in my house. I'm taking dominion over my children, dominion over my marriage, dominion over my body. Amen. I'm taking it because I know who I am, and I'm the church. Amen. And since the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And it goes on to say, and I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. That, who is he talking to? He's talking to the believers. He's talking to you and me. This thing, listen to me. Church is not about a pretty word, a whole bunch of dancing and shouting. It's about all that stuff. That's good. We don't get all that, amen. But if you don't walk out of here and know who you are, the devil will meet you at your car. You walk out there, the devil said, give me them keys, I'm driving. You get over there and sit down somewhere. And you'll be physically in your seat driving, but he'll be talking to you. I'm telling you, he got them demons out there at your car waiting for you to walk out of this church so he can tell you what you're going to do next. I'll let you go to church, but come on, let's go this way. If you don't bind him, if you don't bind them thoughts, if you don't bind them things coming to your mind, if you don't bind them things coming to your house, you know, because Christ is on the inside of you, you know some things are wrong. Sometimes our children ask us to do things. I'm talking about parents, and we know that we really don't want to let them do that. But we say, well, I'm going to let them do it because. And we know on the inside of us, we see all these stop signs and flags. But the world, our mind is on the world, and we want them to fit in. We want this and we want that. And the Lord said, no. And we don't yield to the stop sign. We think, oh, it'll be all right. No, it ain't going to be all right. The devil is never interested in getting a foothold on your life. The Bible said he sifts us as wheat. Yeah. And you know, he shakes a little particle fall down. He pushes it to the side, look, another particle. And before long, he got enough to roll something up. He got enough to make him something. He ain't got to get the whole thing at one time. He just shifts us, get a little particle to fall, push it to the side, little something else to pull, shift you in your marriage, shift you in your walk with God, shift you in the health of your body. Just get enough, and before long, he got enough to create that. He ain't trying to get the whole foot. He get a little bit at a time, and then he got enough to grab hold of you, your toe, and then your ankle, and then your leg, and all the way up, and now he got you. That's his objective. So we cannot give him a free pass. We can't say, oh, it's okay. Listen to me. It's not okay. It's going to work out. It's not going to work out. It's going to be all right. It's not going to be all right. The devil got a strategic plan. The wiles of the devil is strategic. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principality. That means the devil got lieutenants, he got privates, amen. He's got sergeants, he's got generals and demons. He's got all this whole fort set up, and he's got each one of us. Got a plan for everybody's family. I'm going to destroy your marriage. I'm going to destroy your children. I'm going to do this. The devil got a plan for all of that. And we're sitting around idle, not praying, not taking the calling, not confessing in the name of Jesus that we're healthy, that we're wealthy, that we speak those things that we're going through. If you're sick, you speak about sickness. If you're broke, you speak about being broke. But we don't speak those things that God tells us to speak. When we see these things coming, you just think, oh, you ain't got no money because your job ain't paying you well. It's the devil. Praise God. Amen. Go to the next one. We have the keys to the kingdom. Whatever we bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Amen. Whatever we loose on earth will be loose in heaven. When it said, whatever we bind on earth will be bound in heaven, that means, James, stand up. Pastor Corey, stand up right there where y'all at. Come here for a second. Amen. So I'm in heaven. I'm God in heaven. And God said, whatever you bind on earth, I'm gonna bind in heaven. So when Pastor Corey make his mind up, he gonna grab a hold of that sickness in his body, grab a hold to it. Yeah. God grab it in heaven.
Yeah.
Whatever he bind on earth, God bind in heaven.
Glory.
Amen.
Amen.
Whatever he loose, God loose.
Yes.
God can't do anything until you do it.
Yes.
You want God to do it, and you pray, and God said, no, until you act upon it. By faith.
Yeah.
Until you release your faith and act upon it, heaven cannot move. Heaven cannot move. He said, because you got dominion. You have dominion. I've given you authority. And I've given you dominion. So you expect me to do it in heaven, and then you do it on earth. You want me to do it in heaven, and then you see it, and then you know. God said, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. When you make your mind up down here, heaven will make their mind. You make your mind up, I'm gonna live and not die. I'm taking back my family. I'm taking back my health. I'm taking back my mind. Amen. The devil wanna make you think you are so far, you know, lost it. You should have did this a long time ago. If I would have known this a long time ago, I'd be fine. The devil is a liar. You can make your mind up right now. Today I'm gonna take over. Today I'm gonna take back. Amen. Today I'm going to turn my life around. Today I'm going to talk right. Today I'm going to hang out with the right people. Today I'm going to do those things that I wish I would have did when I was young in Christ, but I can't help that. I'm not there. Now all things are what? Passed away. Now I got knowledge. I'm about to start living right. And every day, Smith Wiggins would wake up every morning, 10 minutes every morning, he would wake up and he would pray just for that day.
Amen.
Bless me this day. This day, God, bless me this day. Give me wisdom this day. Give me guidance this day. Let me make good decisions this day. That's all you got. That's all you got right now. And so you can't look back. The devil wants you to look back. Because he ain't in your future. He's not in tomorrow. So the only thing he can get you to do is look back. And try to drag your past into your future. He's not in your future. He don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. He just makes suggestions, lies. He just lied. And so now you get into tomorrow, and now he's in tomorrow with you. He's not, God is already in your tomorrow. He already knows. So you got to be smart enough to say, devil, shut up. Shut up. Shut up. Don't speak. You're not in my future.
Amen.
You don't know nothing about me.
Amen.
You don't know nothing about me.
Hallelujah.
And you need to act like he don't have no power over you. Yes, he knows nothing about you.
Right.
Okay. For the promises is to you and to your children and to all who are afar off, as many as the Lord our God will call. The promise. The promise. The promise of authority, the promise of power, the promise of God is for is not only for the disciples and the ones that they would bring into the knowledge of God, but it's for you. And it's for me. Those who God have called. Calling means it's not called to preach, it's not called to minister, it's called out of darkness into light. And every one of us, God has called. So the promise for the power, the promise for the authority has been given to us.
Amen.
We got to recognize. We got to recognize the source of our power.
Amen.
You got to recognize the source of power.
That's right.
Little Indian boy rode his horse down to a little village, to the general store. He walked in the general store and he saw this light. The light was shining real bright and just really drew his attention. He had never seen anything like it before. And he asked the man at the store, he said, do you sell those? And the man said, yeah, we sell those. He said, I want to take one of those back to my village. So the man sold him one. He got a little light, passion. He couldn't wait to get back. He got back and he sat down. He told those his tribe, he said, watch this. He said, when it got dark, set that thing down. And he was real disappointed because it wouldn't shine. It wouldn't shine. But what he didn't know was out back at the general store, the man had a generator. That was the source that gave it the light. And so we don't shine on our own.
That's right.
There is a source that causes your light to shine. Cannot shine in darkness on your own and with your own knowledge. You have to be connected to the generator. And for the believer, the generator is Christ Jesus. If we're not abiding in him and his word abiding in us, our light will not shine. And when your light is not shining, that means you're not able. The Spirit of God is not on you. If your light is not shining, that means you're in darkness. You are constantly in your child of God. He had the little light there. That represents a child of God. But if it's not shining, it's no different than the darkness. If you're not shining because you hadn't recognized your source, and you're not allowing that source to cause you to shine, when you shine, you'll pray. When you shine, you'll fast. When you shine, you'll walk with God. When you shine, you'll help other people. You'll pray for other people. When you shine, you'll protect your family. When you shine, you'll come to church. You won't miss church because of this, that, or the other. You will press your way to church. Amen. People leave and move other places and go other places, and they cannot find a church home. Your spiritual life is more important than anything else. Listen, you are not going anywhere. You are not going anywhere. You leave here, you are not going anywhere until you know you got a place to feed your soul. That has to be as important as your job. As important of where you're going. If you don't have a place that can feed your spirit, you are not going. That's how you got to look at your spirit. If you're not a member here and you out somewhere else and you just roaming around, you better be somewhere that's feeding your spirit. Amen. Feeding your spirit like you being fed right now. It don't always taste good doing that. Amen. It don't taste good going down. Castor oil our mama used to give us didn't taste good going down. But it sure did the trick. Amen. I don't know if you felt better because it tasted so bad or if you felt better because it really worked. But either way, it did what it needed to do. The word may not feel good, but it's true. It's the truth. Amen. Come on, stand up with me. Was that my last one?
Praise
God. Recognize. Recognize your source of power. Recognize your source of power. This is for every believer in here. Recognize your source of power. Recognize your source of power. This is a disciple making church.
Amen.
That's what this is right here. You are a disciple. You got to disciple your family. You got to be there for your family. Man, if you're not there for your family, you might as well just hand them over to the devil because that's what you're doing. You might as well just put their hand in the hand of the devil. Because if you're not praying for them, and bringing them to church and spending time with them at home, telling them about Jesus.
Amen.
Telling them about the Lord. And I'm going to say something to the young parents today. Young parents today. You can't raise your child like your mama raised you.
Amen.
I'm glad me and Henrietta don't have little bitty children we got to raise today. Because it's just too much to watch over. Man, it's... I'm telling you, man, that devil was coming through a lot of different ways when we were raising our kids. But all these electronic devices now, all this stuff now they can put their hands on that's deceiving our little babies. That's little you gotta watch the phone, the pad, the internet, the TV. Your parents today have got to be on guard for their children. And the deceiving thing is, this is the deceiving thing right here. You think you can trust that child. It ain't the child. The child means well. You can't trust the devil with your child. And your child don't know the little subtle things that are out there that's just reeling them in. Now you got friends, and they got friends, and they hang out with the friends, and the friends may not be raising them the way you raising your child. And so you not only got to watch your child, you got to know little Johnny, mama, and dad. Then what little Johnny into? And your child don't know even what to come home and tell you today. They ain't hiding anything from you. They just don't know what they saw just went in and planted a seed. What they heard just went in and planted a seed. Boy, I tell you, you got to lay your hands on them babies. You can't be with them every second. You can't worry about them every hour of the day. But what you can do is put all on your hand. And put your hand on your baby and say, Lord, anything that they've encountered today, from the devil that's trying to wreck their mind and wreck their life. Any seeds, I uproot them right now in the name of Jesus. I pray against what they saw. I pray against the things they saw or heard today. You got to do it every day. Every day. You got to bind it every day. Because you got the keys to the kingdom. You got to bind it. You got to protect it. You got to cover it. In the name of Jesus. And I tell you, that's what parents got to do today. You can't be so busy about your career, so busy about this, that, and the other. You got to cover them children. Because the devil, he got stuff everywhere. I'm telling you, when we grew up, it wasn't everywhere. We had 3 channels on our TV. 12 o'clock, you got the little snow. You know. Oh, I wish I was in the land of cotton. All the time. Look at what, y'all remember that at the end? You know, TV go off. That was it. That was it. 12 o'clock, man, youth. That was it. Gun smoke went off. That was it. That was it. Couldn't, and the radio signal was so weak. You know, by the time you got tuned into one station, you know, it was so scratchy. We were listening to country music. You know, but look at today. Look at today. People working 7 days a week. The devil said, I'm going to increase the work hours to increase the debt, to keep them from going to church, to keep them from assembling, to keep them from being the church that the gates of hell will not prevail against. And now we broke down, wore down, torn down, tired, disgusted, sicker than ever before. And if you don't see the hand of the devil, got to pray for each other. Take dominion. Recognize the source of your power. Jesus is the source of your power. Come on, lift your hands up. Father, we've heard your word this morning. Father, we receive it in our hearts that we would recognize that Jesus Christ is the source of our power.
Yes.
And that we would live our life as he is in this world. So are we right now, God.
Yes.
We have dominion over the health of our body.
Yes.
We take dominion over the health of our body. We take dominion over our finances. We take dominion over our lives. No matter what life you have lived, no matter what life we have lived, we take dominion over them today. And we walk with you, God, through our prayers and our meditation, through coming to church and listening and hearing your word, through reading our Bible. We take dominion back, dear God. We take dominion over our life, dear God. And we do it today, Lord. We do it today. We thank you, Lord, for watching over us. We thank you for your grace that has abounded towards us. Even when we were out doing our own thing, God, you still watched over us. You still protected us. But Lord, we know, dear God, that we have a great commission, a great assignment, that we would go out and make disciples. And first, that we would be ministers of our own homes, priests of our own homes, that we would pray and lay hands on our children and on our mate, that we would lift you up everywhere we go, on our jobs. We will do it, God. We'll take dominion. Beginning today, I will take dominion over my life in the name of Jesus. We pray, amen.
Amen.
If you're here today and you have not received Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, you say, I'm here and I've not received Jesus. I don't have Jesus as my personal Lord and Savior. I want to receive him today. I want to receive Jesus today. I'm physically alive, but I know without Jesus, I am spiritually dead. If you're here today, I'm inviting you to come. I'm inviting you to come. Come today. Maybe you're here and you say, Pastor, I have a relationship with Jesus, but I don't have a place of worship, and I need a place of worship. I need a church where I can grow. And I believe this is where the Spirit of the living God is leading me to come. And I want to be here today. I want to join today so that I can begin to grow. Amen. I want to be here today so I can begin to grow. Hey, we can't promise you anything but the word of God.
Amen.
We can promise you a whole lot of that.
Amen.
And that your life will change if you obey it and follow it. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. Is there one more? You hear today and you say, I need a place of worship. I'm inviting you to come now. Amen. Well, praise God.
Amen.
Thank God. This is a brother loves mother.
Amen.
Praise God. Is it Jamaica? Michael, Jamaica? Shemichael. Shemichael. This is grandmother. Amen. And we just thank God for you coming and being a part of Abounding Grace. It always blesses my heart when our senior Christians become a part of Abounding Grace.
All right.
Amen.
Yeah. Situations come, how you have to just not be intoxicated with those situations. Brother Love did an awesome job teaching us on that night. Those situations come, they come and intoxicate you, but you have to remain sober. You know, and it was so beautiful how he spoke that word in class, and then how Brother Love came back and did it. And the following day, I mean the next day, he and his wife learned that they had lost their baby. Mm-hmm. And they were pregnant. And they miscarriage. And he had to take that word.
Right. Yeah.
And he had just went over less than 24 hours ago.
Right.
And applied.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Couldn't just talk it next.
Yeah.
He had to take it. He had to apply.
Amen.
And I'm so proud of them.
Amen.
It's hard to lose a baby. You know, it's hard to do it. So stand up with me and point this way. We're going to pray. We're going to pray for Valerie. Amen. Darryl. You know, it's so beautiful to talk to Darryl before he got home after Valerie had called him. And he was worried about Valerie. And when he got home, I said, how's Valerie doing? He said, she's doing all right, but she just worried about me. Ain't that good? He worried about her. She worried about him. Amen. That's where it's supposed to be. Amen. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you. We thank you, Lord, for this couple, for Valerie, Lord, for Darryl, dear God, and for their family, Lord. God, we thank you, dear God, that you are. You brought them through this situation. You're bringing them through it, God. Father, we thank you for how you've comforted their hearts. Please comfort Valerie's heart, dear God, through this trial, dear God. We know, dear God, that you are God and that they never doubted you, Lord. Even through this, God, they never looked down at you at all, dear God. They just stood on your word, dear God. Continue to bless them and continue to strengthen them, Lord. Thank you for being with them and with the girls, dear God, right now. And as they go through this process, Lord, over these next few days, dear God, we pray that you will continue to encourage and strengthen. We bind the hand of the adversary from trying to create doubt and unbelief, dear God, and try to make them believe that it was their fault, Lord. It was nobody's fault, God, but the devil. He's the only one we blame, dear God. But God, we praise you and we thank you, Lord, for this victory in their life, dear God. And we thank you, dear God, at the next appointed time, that you will bless them, dear God. And that we will stand here, Lord Jesus, celebrating with them as we're celebrating today, dear God. In your son, Jesus' name. Amen. Let's prepare our hearts for the ministry of communion.
Amen.
Amen. Now, communion is a time when we see Jesus and his blood shed for us, his body broken for us. And when we see Jesus high and lifted up, it's a time when we know that his body was broken, that our body would be whole. It's a time that we know that all of our sins are under his blood. Amen? Amen. So we receive communion here at Abounding Grace every Sunday. Amen. Because Paul said, as often as you do this, you do show the Lord's death until he comes. Amen. You ought to do this at home if you're sick in your body. You ought to get you some bread and get you something to drink. Amen. And pray over it and remember Jesus. Amen. Amen. This is not something that you have to do only at church on first Sunday. This is not something that you can't do. You can do this at home.
Right.
Amen. Yeah. And if you're sick in your body or you're diseased in your body, you ought to receive your communion. Amen. You ought to remember Jesus. That's what we do today. Hold that bread up. Say, Jesus,
thank you
that your body
is
broken
so that my body
would be healed.
In Jesus' name.
Amen. So your bodies are healed in Jesus' name. Hold that cup of wine up. That's the blood of Jesus. Look at it. That's the blood of Jesus.
All my sins
are under
his blood.
Amen.
Praise God.
Choose the group that you want to sit in on, and you can go and sit with that group. But I want everybody here at Abounding Grace to come. I know you're busy. I know all of that. But I'm telling you, just give us an hour that night. Come out at 6:30 and come to Bible study. Get your journal.
Amen.
Have your verse. Go through it that week. You have your facilitator, your teachers will make contact with you that week. But come to Bible study. This is not enough. You got to be in Bible study. It's really Bible study. We give you a verse. We talk about that verse, and you're in a small group, and it's working out so well. And those of you that have been coming to Bible study, I am depending on you to go out and tell somebody about Jesus, that you would disciple somebody, that you would identify somebody, that you can begin to disciple. We cannot look at ourselves as a body of believers that just come here and everything happens here and it don't happen again until we get here the next time. We got to come here and go forward and serve.
Amen.
Somebody needs to know what you're learning here.
Amen.
You got to be able to take it out of here. So I'm asking you, as your pastor, overseer, the person who's praying for you, and I do pray for you, and I pray for you sometime by name. If the Spirit of the Lord put your name in, as I'm praying for Abounding Grace, I pray for your family, I pray for your children, I pray for your grandchildren, I pray for I pray for stuff just to happen that you need to happen that day. Whatever needs to happen that day, I said, Lord, let whatever Abounding Grace member, let it happen. Bless them today. Open doors and no man can close. And I'm asking you to come to Bible study, 6:30, and come regular, come faithful. Don't just come this Wednesday. Come all the time.
Amen.
Come, amen, so that we can grow.
That's right.
Not the ministry. You can grow and go out. We need this.
Amen.
We need it.
Amen.
So I'm encouraging you to come. My facilitators, stand up facilitators, if you're here today and you facilitate a class, all the facilitators, stand up.
Amen.
Okay. All right. Praise God. And there are more. There are more, amen. Minister Mike handles our youth group, amen. And we got groups all over the place.
That's right.
And I'm excited about it. So please come this Wednesday at 6:30. Put it on your schedule. You know, we send messages out, but come to Bible study. It's truly Bible study. Amen. Let us prepare our hearts for the ministry of giving. Amen.
God has started taking dominion in every area of our lives and in the lives of those around us. Amen.
Amen.
We have authority over everything on this earth, and it's time to start using it. Amen.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Put those angels to work. Amen.
Yes.
Hallelujah. I don't do the word no more disservice by coming behind it, but this is a word that wakes us up to the things that we're responsible for.
Yes,
amen.
Yes.
Hallelujah. So, real quick, Pastor Rita has some bumper stickers available. I don't know if you guys have seen, I don't have any on me right now, but we sold them before, now we got some more in. They're just $5, and if you want to purchase one of those, see Pastor Rita after service. She should be in the back, okay?
Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
Let me just say this before Pastor Brinkman. How many of you read the last book I did? Have you received since you believe? Amen. Let me tell you something. I'm encouraging you to get that book. Get that book. I've got probably 6 or 7 interviews this month with national radio stations all around the country. And what they had me to do before they would book me on their show was to send them a book. And they read it and they love it. I want my family to read it. You know what I'm saying? And so I get calls and emails about the book every single day. Somebody has stuck it on their blog, had put it on their blog page, and this and that. And I'm saying the book is really blessing people. But I wanted to bless Abounding Grace. So please see Miss Deborah and get a book. And don't just get it and take read it. Read it, read it, read it. And I believe it's going to bless you. That's the whole purpose of these books, is to read them and you know, for them to bless you. I'm supposed to go to TDN next month. Amen. I'll be on there. I'll be on there. Good show. to talk about it, and I had to lock the day in because there's another show that want me to do it, and I'm trying to go up there one time to be in that area to do it at the exact same time, so we won't have to make two trips up there. But I want it, when you hear it, I want you to be able to say, yeah, I read it, and I want you to be able to tell somebody else about it. Because I believe it blessed you. I was so blessed when Rhea, amen, emailed me and told me she had read it, and that, you know, Kathy and others of you have said the same thing. Emma, amen, and told me, it just blessed me, you know. So please, take time to read it. Not because I wrote it, but because it will bless you. It will bless you.
Amen. I'm also witness of that book. I'm not pumping Pastor up, but I'm not trying to give him a pat on the back, even though it's a good book. But I couldn't put the book down. And it's info in that. It's stuff in that book I've heard before, and I still couldn't put the book down. 2 days it was already read, and I was like, wow, I wish it was a little more to it. Amen. But don't read it because, like he said, don't read it because he wrote it, but read it because it's some life in that book that'll give you life.
Amen.
Hallelujah. $10. You're investing in your spiritual walk. Put $10. Amen. Life changing too. Amen. We got men's ministry meeting this upcoming Saturday at 9:00 here with the great, honorable Willie White. But Reverend White will be here in the back. Every time we assemble, it's just a blessed time. Men are encouraged. Men are built up. Just make a sacrifice to get out here. It's only an hour and a half. There's food provided, but you're going to be uplifted and you're going to be encouraged. I can guarantee you those things from our great Dr. Willie White. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Also, Sister Allie, please stand real quick. Y'all don't stand up over there. Y'all give Allie a hand. I'm going to tell you why in a second. Sister Allie had her graduation this past Friday from nursing school. And it's such a blessing because God has shown her so many things through her journey and achieving this great goal. And we're just so proud of you, Allie. And we thank God for what he's shown you through this. And we know you're going to go out and do some great things. I feel a lot better about going to hospitals than Allie working there. Amen? Thank God. Thank you, Allie. Last but not least, y'all say love.
Love.
Not Dr. Love. Talk about love. Amen. The real love. Well, we love our pastor first lady, right?
Amen.
So out of that love, we're going to celebrate them in this upcoming December. Hallelujah. I think my sister left, but thank God our sister got baptized on the day. I think she had to get out of here. But that's what came up to me. She said, I want to be baptized. I said, well, you didn't say nothing but a word. That's a good one. Amen. But praise God. That's just a celebration time for us. Amen. Hallelujah. We thank you, Father God, for the word on today. We thank you for the authority that's been freely given to us through Christ Jesus so that we can go out and destroy the works of the adversary. Thank you, Father, for making us cognizant and mindful of the devices of the adversary on this week. Help us to walk in the Spirit and walk boldly in what we've been called to do in the name of Jesus. Help us be mindful of walking as a disciple and walking as a child of God so that we can operate more like Christ, because we are called to be Christ-like in the name of Jesus. Let our speech and our actions line up with what we heard on today so that we can go out and change things, not only in our lives, but in the lives of people all around this world, and destroy all of the devil's tactics in the name of Jesus. Just as tactical as he is, we'll be even more tactical in the way we're going out and affecting the world for Jesus. We thank you, Father, that as we leave this place, you protect us. Hordes of angels are encamped around us to keep us as we go home. Our homes aren't touched. Our homes aren't tampered with. And thank you, Father, for keeping us until we assemble together this coming Wednesday for Discovery Bible Study. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.